cord there. There it is.
You want me to sit there so I can zoom it?
That's up to you.
Second Thessalonians chapter 2. Change throughout scripture, and you have to pay close attention to these changes. In verse number 1, Paul says, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that the day of Christ is at what? At hand." Alright? He says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come." You see that? Now, when Paul's writing 2 Thessalonians, the day of Christ was not at hand. But when you go back and read in the four Gospels, what was a common word that they preached? Repent, for the kingdom is what?
At hand.
At hand. So it was at hand during Christ's earthly ministry. When you get into the early part of the book of Acts, Paul or Peter writes in Acts chapter 2, Luke recording Peter's message on the day of Pentecost, and Peter says what's happening there is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel, saying in the last days. So the last days, it was at hand, and they were in the last days in the early part of Acts. Yet when you get to Paul's letters, he says it's not at hand. He said that day shall not come. He said, "Let no man deceive you by any means, as that the day of Christ is at hand." So you get into Paul's letters, it's not at hand anymore. You know what Paul said about the last days? He said, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come." Future tense. Peter said that the last days were here. Paul said they weren't. They were future. Then when you get over to the book of Revelation, John is told, "Seal not the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is what? At hand." Now, we covered this last week about the mystery of Israel's blindness. Israel's being offered their kingdom in this little period right here. Israel's being offered their kingdom. Because of their rejection, God sent salvation to the Gentiles. We call this the church age. At the end of the church age, God turns back to Israel, and then their kingdom comes at the second coming. Alright, but Paul's saying right here, he said, "Let no man deceive you by any means." You have these men out here today setting dates. I like to take stabs at it from time to time, but I'm not dogmatic at it. Oh, that guy putting up them billboards. I mean, y'all seen them billboards. Christ coming back May of 2000, when was it? 2011. He's done changed his date, so they had some miscalculations. Now they're back at it again. That's about the third or fourth time that guy's done that.
I knew that was wrong, but that was on my birthday.
Yeah. But Paul says that day shall not come. Two things have to happen for the day of Christ to come. Two things. Number one, there must come a falling away. That is, men must turn their ears from the truth unto fables. There must be an apostasy to take place before the day of Christ comes. There must come a falling away first. Why? Because Paul wrote in Romans He said that because of Israel's unbelief, God set them aside. He said, but thou standest by faith. He said, behold the goodness and severity of God. To them that fail, Israel, that's the severity of God. But unto you, goodness. If you continue in his goodness, otherwise thou also shall be cut off. So God promised that as long as the Gentiles would continue in his goodness, then his goodness would continue towards them. But the second that the Gentiles turned from the goodness of God, that God would also cut them off. And he will turn back to Israel. Now I just ask you one thing. Have the Gentiles continued in the goodness of God? We're in the apostasy. We truly are in the apostasy. Men have turned their ears from the truth unto fables. I mean, you've got 15 plans of salvation just in this area right here. Amen? So we've seen the falling away, but something else has to happen. And that man of sin be revealed. The son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he is God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. I'm not going to read all the way down through here, but we're going to go over a couple of these verses. Now, what these verses are dealing with here in chapter 2 is the revelation of a man in the last days. There's going to be a man revealed. A man right here called the man of sin. The Bible calls him the son of perdition. Does anybody else know who had that title, son of perdition?
Judas.
Judas.
Judas Iscariot, yes. We'll get to that. But it's talking about the day that there's going to be a man revealed, the revelation of the man of sin. All right? Now when he comes, look down in verse number, I believe it's verse number 10. Verse 9. When he comes, even him, even that wicked, whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all what?
Power.
Power, signs, and lying wonders. You see that? Now, I'm going to say some stuff here that's going to upset some folks. But listen, what you got to understand is I got them in my family too. All right, come to Mark chapter 16. That's going to upset some people, especially on the videos we're putting out. Because the majority of the people in this area have followed this nonsense. But I'm going to show you this sign movement and this Pentecostal religion of the last days that started around the early 1900s is a movement to draw people and to get people ready to receive the Antichrist. Mark chapter 16, verses 17 through 18. Christ says something to the effect there. He said, these signs shall follow them that believe. Is that the right verses?
Right.
Yeah.
He says, these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall speak in new tongues. They shall heal the sick. They shall raise the dead. Yada, yada. If they drink any poison or any deadly thing or take up serpents, it shall not harm them. These signs will follow them that believe. You see that? Now, when we start studying the signs in the Bible, I'm going to have to erase this. When we start studying the signs in the Bible and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, they are divided into two categories. You got that? One group of gifts of the Holy Spirit were given as signs. Some of the gifts of the Holy Spirit are for signs. What category does tongues fall into? One group of gifts were for signs, the other group was given for edification. Now, which one did Paul say that tongues fell into? Signs or edification?
Signs.
He said they were for signs. He said, now tongues are for a sign. He said, but he that prophesieth is for what? Edification. So some gifts were given to edify, some gifts were given for signs. Now these two classes of gifts here, this is what people can't get, and I'm going somewhere with this, folks, because we're talking about the Antichrist tonight, and I'm showing you that this area, even in southern West Virginia, is ready for it. Church-going people are ready to receive him. Now these sign gifts here were given for Israel. They were not for you and me.
Right.
You don't believe it, do you? All right? Israel, first off, Israel had a right to look for signs. Their first prophet, Moses, was sent to them, and God sent him with what? Signs. The first miracle in the Old Testament was Moses turning water into blood. The first miracle by Jesus Christ in the New Testament is turning water into wine. God told Israel to look for a prophet like unto Moses. Therefore, when Christ showed up, he had to come with signs. When John the Baptist was in prison and asked, sent his disciples out to ask Jesus Christ if he was the one, or should they look for another, what was John told? Go back and tell John the things that you see and hear. The dead are risen, the deaf hear, the blind see, demons are being cast out. What was he giving him? Signs. Now these signs were given from Jesus Christ to the 12 apostles. And they were for Israel. These signs shall follow them that believe. These signs are for Israel. Come to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Y'all gonna have to flip fast tonight. I mean, these silly Pentecostals, man, I crack up listening to them anymore. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, around verse 21, 22, somewhere down through there. The Jews require a what?
A sign.
A sign. The Jews require a sign. They require it. All right, come to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I'm showing you that the sign gifts were for Israel. So when that period that I just drew up here, when God is full with the Jew and turns solely to the Gentile, the signs cease. Yep. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, beginning in verse 20. I think it says, as it is written. Is that the right verse?
When he starts out, brethren.
Brethren.
14:20?
Yeah, I believe so.
Be not children in understanding.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yep. Brethren, be not children in understanding, howbeit malice be children, but in understanding be men. Tell somebody to grow up in their understanding. Boy, that's tough preaching right there. Get up in a Pentecostal church and preach that message. When they're sitting there blabbering their tongues, get up and say, hey, brethren, won't you grow up? Quit acting like little children. Because he's wanting them to understand something. Listen to what he says. In the law it is written. This is in the book of Isaiah. In the law it is written. With men of other tongues and other lips will I speak unto this people. And yet for all that they will not hear me, saith the Lord. Now what is that talking about? God's saying back in the book of Isaiah, I'm going to use the tongues of Gentiles and the lips of Gentiles to speak to my people Israel, and yet for all that they will not hear me, saith the Lord. Wherefore, look at what he says, here's his conclusion. Wherefore, tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, but to them that believe not. But prophesying serveth not for them that believeth not, but for them which believe. You know what he was saying? Tongues were for a sign to Israel.
Right.
You know how these churches preach it around here? Have you received the evidence of the Holy Spirit, the initial evidence in the speaking of tongues? They use it as a sign as you have received the Holy Spirit. Paul said it wasn't a sign for you.
Right.
It wasn't a sign for them that believe. It was for a sign to Israel.
Amen.
Now keep reading what he says. If therefore the whole church be gummed together into one place, now watch, here's a contradiction in the Bible. Alright, you ready? Within two verses of each other, Paul contradicts himself. If therefore the whole church be come together into one place and all speak with tongues, and there come in those that are unlearned or unbelievers, will they not say that ye are all mad? You know, didn't he just say that tongues were for a sign to them that believe not?
Right.
And then he just said, if a bunch of unbelievers come into your church and you're speaking in tongues, they're going to think you're all crazy. And I tell you what, I've been in their churches. I think they're all about half nuts. Amen? What's he talking about? The unbelievers he talked about tongues being a sign word for was Israel. You go back to the book of Acts and you find, if I'm wrong on this, every time somebody spoke in tongues in the book of Acts, there were Jews present.
Right. Amen.
Every single time. It was a sign to them. Peter wouldn't have even baptized Cornelius had he not spoken tongues. It wasn't until he spoke in tongues that Peter said, "Can any forbid these men to be baptized, seeing that God hath given unto them the same Holy Ghost that he has given us?" Had they not sat and spoken tongues that day, Peter, being a Jew, would have never baptized them.
No.
You follow me? These signs were for Israel. Alright, Hebrews chapter 2, verses 3 through 4 says that the gospel, alright, flip over there. You gotta get this stuff, man. You gotta get it. I was gonna rush through it, but you gotta get it. This is where people are getting messed up today. Because they don't take time and they don't care about words. They don't care what the Bible says. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 3 through 4 says, How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? The way. Now, I mean, if you're reading the Bible, man, reading comprehension. How many of y'all know what that is?
Understanding.
You should be sitting and asking yourself, okay, if we, who's the we here? How shall we escape? Who's the we?
Jews.
The name of the book is Hebrews. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation which at the first began to be spoken by who?
The prophets.
The Lord.
The Lord.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You should be. Which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord. That's Jesus Christ. You back to Hebrews 1:2 said, God in these last days has spoken unto us, the Jews, by his Son. Now the salvation which at first began to be spoken by the Lord was not the same salvation spoken to the Gentiles today. The salvation which at first began to be spoken by the Lord was the national salvation of Israel. Y'all follow me? And it was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, the 12. God also bearing them witness both with signs and wonders and with diverse miracles. The signs were for Israel and they deal with the gospel of the kingdom.
Right.
Now once God was done with the Jew, the only gifts of the Holy Spirit left today. You follow me? The only signs left, or the only gifts left for us today, are the ones that are for edification. And that list is found in Romans chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 12. But you got to be careful in 1 Corinthians 12 because some of the sign gifts are there. But Ephesians chapter 4 verses 8 through 12 gives you those gifts as well. Apostles, prophets, well there's no more apostles either, but prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers. You get over into Romans, helps and hospitality. You know? You know where Paul ranked tongues in the list of gifts? Very bottom, man. They were at the bottom. He said he has set first apostles, then prophets, thirdly this, fourthly this, and lastly tongues. And that's the one they all want, man. Hasta the Sunday, tie a bow tie, you know, all that nonsense. It's not for us. It doesn't exist. There isn't a person in this world speaking tongues today like they were back in the book of Acts.
Yeah.
Now, what's all this have to do with anything? Well, the Bible teaches us that in the last days, these were called signs of an apostle, by the way. 2 Corinthians 12:12. Acts chapter 5. The every ordinary Christian didn't get these signs. Acts chapter 5 said the rest of the church wouldn't even join themselves unto the apostles, but magnified them. And by their hands were wrought many miracles. But the Bible tells us that as we approach the last days, now these sign gifts have ceased after the book of Acts. Acts chapter 28, Paul's in prison. salvation's going to the Gentiles. These are the only gifts left. Those that are designed for the edifying of the body of Christ. The sign gifts are no longer here. But the Bible warns us time and time again, that in the last day, there is going to be a revival of signs. But they're not going to come from God. That when these signs and wonders show up, they're a part of the man of sin. 2 Corinthians 3:8 says, or 2 Timothy 3:8, Paul said, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Y'all, and people just tear through life. Don't believe it, do you? You don't think it's at all possible that 95% of Christians in southern West Virginia are deceived, do you? I tell you what, just take your Bible and give it the boot, man. Because somebody's lying. Either you're lying or that Bible's lying. And my money's on you.
Right. Amen.
When it said evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse, not only is that contrary to everything Charles Darwin ever said about evolution, and it's contrary to the Catholic doctrine of the City of God written by somebody help me out here, Augustine, back in 325, talking about how the Catholics were going to bring in the millennial kingdom, and then we were going to get better and better until the kingdom showed up. The Bible said it would get worse and worse, and there would be more deception the closer you got to the time of the end.
Right.
Well, I don't care where they go to church as long as they go somewhere. That's the rantings of a fool.
Amen.
Especially when your Bible told you evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. You got it? Revelation 13:13-14. Remember the battle of the prophets of Baal back there in the book of Kings? Elijah. Boy, Elijah, he's a smart elk. I love Elijah. He was a smart elk, kind of like me, man. He said, I'll tell you what, boys. He said, we'll have this little battle. He said, if God be God, serve him. How long hold ye between two masters? If the Lord be God, serve him. If Baal be God, serve him. He said, I'll tell you what, let's do. Let's get two altars. Put a bullock on it. He said, whichever God answers by fire, he said, let him be God. And it was him and, you know, all the prophets of Baal. Elijah was standing alone. He said, I'll even let you go first. And they got up there and started going first, and Elijah started to mock him. You know. Maybe your God's on vacation. Cry louder. Maybe he's using the bathroom. Maybe he's on the telephone. Maybe he's taking a nap. And they even got to where they started cutting their arms with knives, trying to get this God to hear him, never answered. Elijah was so confident what God was going to do, he took, dug a moat around his altar and filled it with water. Amen? And all he said was, Lord, hear me that these people may know that you are Lord God of Israel. Fire come down and consume them. You know what Elijah did with them prophets? Took them down and slaughtered them. Got the people, taken down there and killed them. Now listen, there's coming a time very soon to this earth in which that same battle is going to take place.
Yeah, amen.
Elijah's going to be back on this earth. That's Revelation chapter 11. That's Malachi chapter 5. Elijah will be back on the earth. And there's going to be a prophet in Revelation 13:13-14 that has power to call down fire from heaven. Now the prophets of Baal couldn't do it. This time, the false prophets are going to have enough power to call down fire from heaven. And all these sign-following Christian, I use that term loosely, all these sign-following religious people in this world, if they're left here after the rapture, they'll believe the false prophet.
Right.
Matthew 24:24, Jesus Christ said this. That verse don't sound right at all. It is. He says, for there shall arise false Christ and false prophets that shall show great signs and wonders, in so much that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Mm-hmm. What's Christ telling us? In the last days you're going to have a revival of signs and wonders. But it has nothing to do with biblical Christianity. It has to do with the coming of the Antichrist. And we're seeing it more and more, folks.
Amen.
More and more churches are turning from the Word of God to these fables and these signs and these wonder churches.
Amen.
And it's priming and prepping people for the coming of the man of sin.
Right.
Who when he comes with all power, signs, and lying wonders.
Amen.
The signs were for Israel, but these signs that are about to show up on this earth, I've heard people say, I went to Benny Hinn and I seen him make a man's leg grow by 10 inches. I seen Chris Angel climb up the side of a building. Who cares?
Amen.
I mean sleight of hand, man. I mean, I can levitate. Y'all want to see it? Get it right, it ain't weird. You ready? I mean, it's just trickery, smoke and mirrors.
Yeah, amen.
People's stupid enough to follow that, they get what they deserve.
Right.
The power and the signs that are going to show up on this earth are counterfeit lying wonders, and guess who they're a punishment from? They're a punishment from God upon Bible-rejecting people who received not the love of the truth. They didn't love His Word. They didn't read His Word. They didn't believe His Word. They couldn't live by His Word. And so He sends these liars to them with all these signs and wonders so that He might damn all of them.
Right. Amen.
Look in back in 2 Thessalonians. You don't believe it. Look back in 2 Thessalonians. It's a punishment from God upon them who can't believe the book. You know what this Bible says about the New Testament Christian? It says that he walks by faith and not by sight.
Right.
You know what it says in Hebrews chapter 11, 1 is? You know what faith is? Substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. We don't need signs. We have faith. Faith is the substance of our hope. Faith is the evidence of things we can't see. You say, you know you got the Holy Spirit? Yeah, I know I got the Holy Spirit. Why? Because God told me I did, and God can't lie.
Right.
He said, believe on my Son. He said, after you believe, I'll seal you with my Spirit in my Son. You know what I do? I believe you, God. Can I see the Spirit in me? No. Do I have to blabber in tongues to believe it? Uh-uh.
No.
I know I got it because God told me I have.
Amen.
You walk by faith, man. You don't walk by what you see. You walk by what you can't see, but what God has showed you in His Word. But people who cannot believe the Word of God, Christ said, a wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. That's Glenn Daniel Worship. I better be careful.
Go ahead.
Glenn Daniel Full Gospel, Glenn Daniel Worship Center, Church of God, Assembly of God in Arnett, all these Pentecostal churches are full of wicked and an adulterous generation of people who cannot believe what God said, so they're constantly seeking after signs.
Right. Amen.
If you get mad at me, it just shows you who I'll be like Moses. Who's on God's side and who's on their side? I mean, I'm telling you, folks, I've actually done this before. I may not even get to my message tonight, but y'all will hopefully get something out of this. I have literally taken a Pentecostal service and a voodoo service and set them side by side on the television and muted them. Know the difference? Not a thing, man. Not a thing. You got women in both services doing this number. Something taking over their body. Both services, women are falling out, their shirts flying up, exposing their nakedness. And even these women in these voodoo services, when you unmute it, are speaking in a tongue that they don't know.
Amen.
Don't get mad at me. Paul told you that men in the last days would give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils.
Yep, that's right. Amen.
He told you it was coming. We just chose not to believe it, didn't we? Now, the reason God sends and allows this man of sin to come, who comes with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness, with all deceivableness. You've never seen a man that'll be able to deceive like this man. 4 years ago, Barack Obama deceived a whole nation of people into thinking that he was their true hope. But his eloquence and his way of speaking ain't even going to compare with this man that's about to show up in the world.
Amen.
He comes with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved, and for this cause, because they would not receive the love of the truth, for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness.
Right. Amen.
Call down fire from heaven. Raise the dead. They'll have the power to heal. And God allows it to take place because for 2,000 years, preachers have been preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, and men have rejected it and went after signs and wonders instead of the word of God. And as a punishment upon this wicked and adulterous generation that we now live in, he sends them these counterfeit signs and lying wonders that he might damn them to hell. You just read it.
Yeah, right.
That's right.
You're living in that generation. Now, look there in verse 7, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. These are two of the mysteries I didn't cover last week. Verse 7, the mystery of iniquity doth already work. You see, the man hasn't been revealed. The man's not been revealed yet, but the mystery is already at work. There's another mystery over in 1 Timothy 3:16 called the mystery of godliness. Now that's Jesus Christ. But he hasn't been revealed yet either. You say, but he's already been to this earth. Yeah, so is the Antichrist.
Right.
But neither one of them's been revealed. In fact, when I tell you who the Antichrist is, some of you are going to say, I've never heard that before in my life. I don't know if I believe it. I don't care if you believe it or not. Go home, watch sports, Andy. Amen. Go home, watch the bait Tuesday night. I don't care. I mean, I'm telling you, I know who it is. I know what his name is. They were both on the earth at the same time at the first coming of Christ. But Jesus Christ, the only one who saw the true revelation of Jesus Christ was Peter, James, and John. And Paul saw it on the road to Damascus.
Right.
But he's not been revealed. That's what the book of Revelation is about, the revelation of Jesus Christ. Right now, he's a mystery. The world knows nothing about him, folks. The UN don't know who they're messing with.
Amen.
They're messing with a great king.
Amen.
The Bible says, swear not by Jerusalem, because it is the city of the great king.
Right. Amen.
He's now seated down in heaven, but we ain't even seen him as he is yet. John said, it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall see him as he is. Amen? We've not yet seen him as he is. So neither one of these men have been revealed. They're both in a mystery form. Now this mystery of iniquity, though the man's not been revealed, the Spirit has been at work since the creation. Isaiah chapter 14.
All
right. Get over there. Well, we'll have to do this in two parts, so y'all don't start freaking out because I ain't got to this stuff yet. I know what some of you are sitting there thinking right now. He ain't even started on those. We're going to be here all night. I can quit and pick back up anytime. So y'all just bear with me and listen. Isaiah chapter 14, beginning in verse 12. Now, how do you explain there's only one English Bible in the market today that's got this verse right?
Amen.
Something strange about a Bible that comes out in the last days that wants to hide the only place in the Bible where Satan's called Lucifer. And there's also something very strange about them same Bibles making that Lucifer into the light bearer or dawn of the, or son of the morning or morning star, and then turning around and putting references in their little columns there to Jesus Christ in the New Testament.
Right.
You know what's strange about that? What's strange about that is when the Antichrist shows up, he sits in the temple and says, I'm God in the flesh.
Yeah.
So who's he claiming to be? Jesus Christ. So there's something strange about a Bible making Lucifer Jesus Christ.
Yeah, amen. That's right.
I know. Never mind. Isaiah 14, verse number 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. There's NASA. I will set my throne above the stars of God. I will ascend into the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will be like the Most High God. I. Jesus Christ never spoke like that one time while he was on this earth.
Amen.
Not my will, but thine be done. You see? I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. Another will come in his own name. Him ye shall receive. This one comes in his Father's name. This one comes in his own.
Amen.
I. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Boy, let me tell you something. Your country's so primed and prepped for this man to show up, it would frighten you to even think about it.
Absolutely.
The mystery of iniquity. It's been around since the beginning of the creation. His philosophy is for man to be as gods. Little G-O-D-S. People think Satan showed up and said, be as God. Capital G-O-D. Well, that's the only thing God will accept anyway. God wants you to be like himself. When he created man, he created him in his own what?
Image.
And after his own what? Likeness. Satan didn't come and say you shall be as God. Go back and read it. He says, God doth know in the day you eat thereof, ye shall be as gods. Little G-O-D-S, knowing good for evil. Some reading you need to get done sometime in Psalm 82, where it says over there, God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. That's where Satan wanted to ascend. He judgeth among the gods. He said, ye are all children of the Most High, but ye shall die like men. Satan is called the God of this world. You know what Satan was saying? He was saying, if you go ahead and eat that fruit there, you'll be like us. You'll be able to make up your own mind. You'll be able to do what you want to do. You won't have to be what God wants you to be. You'll be able to make up your own mind and be your own God. You know what it is? You know what Satanism is? Matthew chapter 16. You know what iniquity means? It means lawlessness. It means to be lawless. What book did I just say?
Matthew.
Matthew 16:23. That right there reveals what Satan is. He's a humanist.
Yeah.
Humanism. Christ told him, he said, get behind me, Satan. Satan wasn't talking, Peter was. Well, here's what's strange. Within five verses, Peter went from speaking under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. When he said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, Peter said, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. In other words, what you just said was given to you by my Father. He comes down a few verses. Christ said, I got to go up to Jerusalem and die and suffer many things and be risen the third day. Peter said, be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee. And Jesus goes, something changed. Wouldn't you love to have that kind of discernment of spirits?
Amen.
I mean, Christ picked up on the first time and said, that's my Father talking. And then as soon as he says, now here's what I get from the story. Peter was just concerned about his Savior, his Lord. But Jesus is like, hey, you shut your mouth, Savior. He said, I can imagine Peter like, he said, you savor the things that be of men and not the things that be of God. Satan is a humanist. He loves the things of men. He savors the things of men. Do you want to see this mystery at work? Do you want to see it? It's always connected with unity.
Yeah.
And it's always connected with men thinking they can do and achieve things. Amen? The Tower of Babel, let us. There's a word for you. Does this remind you of anything? Let us make us a name. Let us make us a name. That name's coming real soon. They're going to put it in their forehead. Let us make us a name and let us be one, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the earth. And let us build us a tower whose top may reach unto heaven. It looks like this today. That's the Tower of Babel today.
Amen.
Now, folks, don't get mad at me. Who was it that said they would ascend into heaven? Christ said, I am the door. If any man enter in by me, he shall be saved. But anybody that comes by any other way is a thief and a robber.
Satan.
The only one that can get you into the Father's presence and cause you to ascend into the heavens is Jesus Christ. You come any other way, it's because you're a thief and a robber. NASA is full of a bunch of thieves and robbers. That's another one I would cut funds to if I was a part of the government. $16 trillion in debt, get rid of NASA. Amen. Well, we wouldn't have our cell phones. Oh, God help you. I mean, really. That just takes away from more. That just takes away time between us and God anyway.
Amen.
People never have any alone time anymore, man. They got their iPods, their iPhones, their iPads, They're my cars. I mean, I've seen people with cell phones as big as my TV, man, walk around school down there with it like this right here. It's ridiculous. What is it? It's bringing the world together.
Yeah.
God separated them and said, if I don't, they won't be anything impossible unto them. So the satanic and antichrist spirit, this mystery of iniquity, is always connected with unity. Us. We. Yes, we can. Amen?
Right.
The UN. United Nations. United States. European Union. North America, or the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. NAFTA. North American Free Trade Agreement. You know. It's all a process of uniting the world. For what purpose? The only unity God allows is the unity of the Holy Spirit. Any other unity is just satanic. The mystery of godliness is God manifest in the flesh. This one here is God in flesh. This one here is Satan in flesh. Now listen to the differences. The mystery of iniquity says, be God. That's what it says. The mystery of iniquity says, I will ascend. Boy, there's a lot of trick churches preaching that one. Me and God got my own thing worked out. It opposeth and exalteth itself above all that is called God. It opposes and exalts itself. So that he as God sitteth in the temple of God saying, I am God. There's a man on the earth right now that does that. Anybody have any idea who he is?
Papa.
He's the Pope. The Holy Papa. Holy Father. That's what they call him. Holy Father. You know who Jesus called that? There's only one being in that Bible called Holy Father, and it's in John 17 when Christ bows his knee and said, Holy Father.
Amen.
That's right.
You got no business in this, you got no business calling any man on this earth Holy Father.
Right.
No business at all. This man, and we will get to this, but this man can go anywhere in the world and do this right here. And kings will bow their knee and kiss. Kiss. We'll get to that kiss. I know what they're kissing, man. And I know what they're going to be kissing. We'll get to that. Bible talks about a holy kiss. We ain't even got to the head hurting stuff yet, so y'all just bear with me. The mystery of iniquity, man runs things. The mystery of godliness, the mystery of godliness says, not my will, but thine be done. It humbles itself before God. It doesn't exalt itself, it humbles itself. This one here is cast down. When it opposeth and exalteth itself, it's cast down. How art thou cast down? How art thou fallen from heaven? This one humbled itself, and God exalted it. They're different. They're completely different. 100% opposite. Under the mystery of iniquity, man's run things. In the mystery of godliness, Christ subdues it. Says, man, you don't have a will. But I have a right to do this. Yeah, you do. And I also have the right to give you the boot. When Christ comes, he comes to subdue this world back to God. Our government's got it so far out of control, it ain't even funny. I mean, you realize you're living in a day and an age when we are actually debating whether or not the Bible and the Ten Commandments should be allowed in the school at the same time that we're debating whether it's okay to pull a baby that's in its third trimester halfway out the womb and suck its brains out of its head?
Amen.
Somebody needs to come back and do something. And I hear the debate, the economy will fix itself, boy, if you turn back to God.
Right.
Righteousness exalteth the nation, but sin is a reproach to any people, and America's not immune.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
Now that thing right there, that's the Bible in a nutshell. Go to Genesis 3:15. We're just getting set up tonight. Walking Dead starts tonight. Who watches that show? I got 2 hours though before that starts. Four?
You're good. I'm DVRing it. I ain't worried about it. I'm good. You can go all night.
I live with old people. I have DVR at my house, but they don't. All right. Genesis 3:15, you see them two seeds?
We're not too busy to watch it when it's on.
That has nothing to do with the two seeds I just mentioned.
That's part of that old age.
Genesis 3:15, there's two seeds there.
Thy seed and her seed.
Thy seed and her seed. Satan has a seed, folks. There's something strange about Cain that I'm not going to get into, because y'all be like, whoa now. There was something strange about the birth of Cain, because when Eve found out she was pregnant, she said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. Anybody with me?
Yep.
You know what the Bible says about him? You see, the problem with people in church, man, is you tell them this stuff, they be like, I don't know, I've never heard that before. But if I show you that it's in the Bible, why is it so hard to believe for you? You know what the Bible says? 1 John?
3.
About Cain? That he was of that wicked one.
Yep, that's what it says.
I don't believe that's possible. Well, this one here was born of a virgin.
Amen.
And that was called the seed of a woman. And you were told that Satan would have a seed.
Right.
I still don't believe it. Well, get on there. Genesis 6, the sons of God came down and married the daughters of men, and giants were born to them.
Right.
Now, folks, listen. This is what your Bible teaches. Now, don't get mad at me because the sword of the Lord dumbed people down for the last 60 years. I've got books from the 1700s that believe this stuff. It ain't my fault that Shelton Smith and them guys have been dumbing the Baptist church down for the last 40 years. That ain't my fault. This is what the Bible teaches. Now, notice that it said about these two seeds, that it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise its heel. So the seed of the serpent will bruise the heel of the seed of the woman, but the seed of the woman would bruise the head of the serpent. That's the main conflict of the Bible. From the time that Satan hears this in Genesis 3:15, he's constantly trying to kill that man-child and stop him from being born.
Amen.
Yes, he was.
Revelation 12, John looks up and says, I saw a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet, and 12 stars around her head. That's Israel. And next to her was a great red dragon, and she was in pain, ready to be delivered. She was pregnant with child, and that dragon was by her, ready to devour the man-child as soon as it was born.
Yep.
Pharaoh, Exodus. Any man-child comes out of the womb, kill him.
Amen.
The women, spare him alive. Haman over there in the book of Esther, I want every Jew killed. Mm-hmm. Hitler and his Holocaust. There's never been a race of people. You can't explain how a Jew is still on this earth other than the power of God.
Right.
That Jew has been persecuted from the time that it was born through Abraham until today. They've been persecuted by the God of this world. Yeah. Because he hates the woman that brought forth the seed and the man-child. But now listen, these two seeds. Now notice this. The heel will be bruised. The head will be bruised. Now here's the common teaching among ignorant Baptists who don't study their Bible. And I don't mean to say that, folks. Honest to goodness, that was me. Because I fought this for years. And it's easy to think this. Most people think that both bruisings took place at Calvary. The head of the serpent was not bruised at Calvary. In fact, Paul writing in Romans 16 says it's still future. He says, the very God of peace will bruise Satan under your feet shortly. That's over in the book of Romans chapter 16. The head of the serpent is bruised. The man of sin is going to be revealed. Right now, he's in a mystery. The mystery of godliness is in mystery form. The Son of God. But there's going to come a time when this man's revealed, this one's going to be revealed from heaven, and they're going to go to war, and that one's going to be bruised. His head will be bruised. That means that this seed of the serpent was on the earth at the first coming.
Right.
Are you with me? And Jesus told you who it was. But once again, people don't believe their Bible. Jesus chose 12 men. He looks at one of them one day and he says about this man, he said, have not I chosen you 12 and one of you is a devil? what he said. You know who that man was? Judas Iscariot. You know what Judas had the power to do? He had the power to heal people. Judas had the power to cast out devils. Judas had every sign and power and wonder that the 12 apostles had, except Christ said he was a devil. Yeah? Falling for the money bag.
Yeah.
That's them men today. Benny Hinn likes the money bag too. You know what Christ called that man in John 17? Paul called this one. He said, that day shall not come except the come falling away first, and the man of sin be revealed, the son of what?
Perdition.
There's only one other man in the Bible given that name. You want to take a stab at who it is?
Judas.
Jesus Christ prayed in John 17, says, all that you've given me, I have lost none, save the son of perdition, that the scriptures might be fulfilled.
Right.
That man right there, Christ said he was a devil, and he calls him the son of perdition. Could he be the seed of the serpent that God talked about in Genesis 3:15?
Yeah.
Now watch this. Y'all keep up now. Now it's going to start getting deep. Both of these men, this one here is called the man of sorrows. Not the man of sin, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Not the son of perdition, but the son of God. Man, I want to get into the letter of the Lamb so bad I can't stand it right now, but I'm not going to. All right, both these men hung on a tree. Didn't they? Did both of them hang in a tree? Hang on a tree?
Uh-huh.
Both these men prophesied and preached and done signs and wonders for 42 months. This one's got 42 more to come. Revelation chapter 11. Acts, and when Jesus Christ died, he went to the right hand of the Father. He ascended to the right hand of God. Anybody know what happened to Judas when he died? Some of you ain't got any idea.
Went to his own place.
He went to his own place.
Wow. That's not said of any other man in the Bible when he died. Where is that place? The Bible said he went to his own place. Come to Revelation chapter 9. Revelation chapter 9. There's a demon over here that we're getting ready to read about. I don't use the word demon. I don't like that word. A devil. What's calling him a devil? But it's actually called an angel. Revelation chapter 9, verse 11, I believe it is. And there's an angel comes down from heaven having a great key or a key in his hand to a place called the what?
Bottomless pit.
The bottomless pit. Now that's not hell, that's not paradise. The bottomless pit is that great gulf that was between the two. Now if this place is in the heart of the earth, anybody know the laws of gravity? You know why it's called a bottomless pit? We know the earth ain't bottomless. But the laws of gravity state that everything's being pulled to the what?
Center.
So if you get to the center of the earth, you can't move. You're there.
All right.
Also, it'd be a pretty hot place, too, and smoky and dark. Right. Y'all following me? Now, look there. That angel comes down and unlocks the bottomless pit. And out of this pit comes all these... Goodness gracious, man, some of the god-awful looking scorpion locust things in the history. I mean, you've never seen anything like it. They sting you one time, 6 months, you're laid up in the bed like, God, let me die. You say you believe that stuff, every word of it.
Amen.
You say that, you don't think they're helicopters? No, because I've never seen helicopters come out of a pit. People try everything in the world to make the Bible make sense to them. I believe what it said. I believe their locusts was tails of scorpion, teeth like, I believe every bit of them.
Amen.
You say you believe them horses over there with the hair of women and the mouths of lions? Yeah, I do. I believe every word of it. You say you believe in them satyrs in Isaiah 34, them half men, half goat? Uh-huh. Why? Because around the throne of God are a bunch of beings with six wings full of eyeballs in the face of men and the face of lions and eagles, and they can talk.
Amen.
And in the Garden of Eden, the serpent talked to Eve. And it didn't even strike her as funny. Hey, what are you doing talking? Maybe when man fell, maybe animals try to talk to us, and we're just too dumbed down, too ignorant to understand them. Have you ever had an animal give you that look like, really? I mean, what's so hard about understanding I want my belly rubbed, you know? Maybe they're trying, maybe you used to be able to understand them, I don't know. Off subject, but there's a being that comes out of that pit. And his name in Hebrew is, what is it, Abaddon?
Apollyon.
That's in Greek. What's his name in Hebrew?
Abaddon.
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 And in the Greek, his name is Apollyon. Both of these mean the same thing. These are the same Greek words used. This is the same Greek word used right here. Now, what's he called? The king of what? He's called the king of the
underworld.
The bottomless pit.
You'll get it right.
You'll get it right eventually. You want me to give you multiple choice? He's the king of
what?
Alright?
Many.
Do you know what that means? That means the bottomless pit is his. He's the king over. That is, now listen, I'm not talking about the man Judas Iscariot. When Judas died, they put his body in a tomb just like they did Jesus Christ. Amen? But that devil that Jesus said he was went back to his own place. It's called perdition. Come to Revelation 17 if you still don't believe me. We're going to get into this thing about the Antichrist. The Bible's clear on him, man. He's the most important figure in the Bible other than Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
There's more information on this man in the Bible than there is on any other man outside of Jesus Christ. There's no reason for us to not know anything about him. I mean, I know so much about him. Ask my dad. We know so much about him, we can spot him on the Olympic medals.
Right.
I know so much about him, every time NASA shoots a rocket up into space and they call it SpaceX Dragon or whatever it was called. What was that space shot called?
SpaceX.
SpaceX Dragon?
Yeah.
You gotta watch for them words that end in X. We'll get to that. You think I'm lying again, don't you? Y'all's going to be convinced of this thing eventually. All right? So he went to his own place, and that place is the bottomless pit. Revelation 17. I believe it's verse 8. The beast that thou sawest was.
Yeah.
All right? The beast that thou sawest was. Now look here. John's writing A.D. 90. Now the beast, the Antichrist that John saw was, that means when John's writing, that beast had already been here, was, and what?
Is
not, and shall ascend out of what? And go into what?
Perdition.
Oh. Now, who else can you think of was here before John wrote Revelation, was not, and will ascend out of the bottomless pit to go into perdition? It's that same devil that was in Judas Iscariot. I guess y'all just missed that thing over there that time. Now, watch this. Let me get to these numbers, all right? Let me get started. First off, stay in Revelation 17. right? Here's the marks of the Antichrist. You can spot him. You can spot him anywhere, anytime, any place, anytime you want to. By the way, you see that Apollyon? You know what that is in Greek? That's the Greek god Apollo. Many of y'all's heard of Apollo. In Greek mythology, Apollo is a god that's went down to the underworld and is going to come back up. So, God help us, I will ascend into heaven, so when NASA sends their little spacecraft to the moon, and people don't know why, and they don't question this stuff, they call them Apollo. What? What is NASA doing, naming our shots to the moon when we're trying to ascend into heaven? What are they doing naming them after the king of the bottomless pit? One small step for man, one giant leap for who?
Mankind.
Mankind. Thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. Don't take a brain surgeon to know who's behind the space program. Can we live on Mars? Can we do this? Can we do that? Satan's trying to spread his kingdom. You boys understand this, don't you? You don't have a clue. Right. Now this mystery is already at work. We can see and identify it, alright? Now look down at Revelation 17. I gotta get through this real quick. I'm going to give you two things, we'll be done. Now remember the mystery of iniquity. It's in a mystery form. Christ is in a mystery form. There's two mysteries on this earth right now. One of them is the bride of Christ. The other one is the mother of harlots, a great whore. This is the bride of Jesus Christ, the bride of the mystery of godliness. This one is the bride of the mystery of iniquity. All right. Now, let's see if we can identify her. Matthew. I'll get back to these numbers. No, we better go ahead and do it. Hold your spot there, come to Revelation 13. I got to go ahead and give you the numbers. This stuff won't make no sense to you at all. Revelation 13 and 18. Now, the number of this man, the number of the Antichrist, and you can see it everywhere. Anybody ever see that glass pyramid? We talked about the pyramid last week, and Justin had an aneurysm, I know. Did you think about it that night? Anybody ever seen that pyramid they built outside the Louvre in Paris? Anybody ever seen it? A pyramid. You know how many panes of glass it had in it?
Let me guess.
Go ahead. 666. Uh-huh. Strange, a pyramid with 666 panes of glass. But Paul Lucas is crazy. He's off his rocker. They said the same thing about the Apostle Paul. Much learning hath made thee mad, you know. But I mean, folks, when you keep seeing these same anomalies and these same coincidences and these same things over and over and over, you start to say it's not coincidence or something behind it. Now, Revelation 13 and 18. Now, here's what people, what's the mark of the beast?
666.
See, I caught you, didn't I? Now, pay close attention. Read Revelation 13, 8. I believe it's 13, no.
18.
13, 18 is where it gives his number. But look down there, 13. No man may buy or sell. He causeth all men, both small and great, that no man may buy or sell, verse 17, save he that hath the mark. Okay. Or the what?
Name of the beast.
Or
the number of his name.
They're not the same. You're told that they're three separate things. He has a mark, a name, and a number of his name. Now the number of the beast in Revelation 13, 18. The number 18 is what? You folks have been here for a while, y'all should know this. The number 18 is 6 plus what?
7.
What's six?
It's three sixes. And in Revelation 13:18, you're told his number. Let him that hath wisdom count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. And its number is 600,
three score and six.
Now, I ain't got time to do this. I ain't got time to draw it out here and let you see it. But if you count the phrase, if you count the letters in the phrase, 600, three score, and six, it comes out to 26, which is 13 times 2. That's 2 13s. Now, you say, where are you getting this 13 stuff from? Bear with me and I'll show you. So the numbers of the beast, or the numbers, are 6 and 13. What day of the week is Friday?
Friday
the 13th. What day is everybody scared of?
Friday the 13th.
Friday the 13th. Why?
Bad luck.
Where does people get it? This stuff is older than me and you are. I mean, you come and you get this. It's old wives' fables is what it is. But it's rooted as far back as you can go. You go back at 3000 BC to the land of England 3000 years before Christ, and they were still scared of the number 6 and 13. Now people, I mean, why is this? Why? You say, what does the number 13 have to do with it? Well, come to Ezra 2:13, 2 Chronicles 9:13. The number 666 is only in your Bible twice. Three times, count Revelation 13. The third time it shows up, it's in chapter 13 of the book of Revelation. The other two times it shows up, it's in Ezra 2:13, and it's in 2 Chronicles 9:13. This one here talks about how much gold Solomon had. And he had 600, three score, and 6 talents of gold. But this one right here is even stranger. There's a man that it's talking about over there. His name is Adonikam. Looks like this. And that name in Hebrew means Lord of the Rebellion. Or the Lord of Heights, which is also like Baal. Or the Lord of Rising, I will send. How many kids did he have? Come on, let's take a stab.
13.
666. Now he's in the 13th verse, and you know what number in, you know what name in the list he is? He's the 13th name of the list. Now God is trying to do something for you, folks. He put the number 666 in your Bible three times, and he made sure that you associated it with the number 13. Let's get back to this one. Remember Apollo? They made a movie about it, didn't they? What was it called?
Apollo 13.
Hollywood. Hollywood's the most satanic people in the market, boy. I'm telling you they are. Alright, let's keep going. Genesis chapter 10. Y'all know who Nimrod is? Oh my goodness. Give me about 5 more minutes, folks. Nimrod. Let me get this done and explain, because I already drew this up on the board and I know y'all's getting mad at that. We gotta cover that. That's why I don't like Notre Dame, man. His letters look like this. That's the letters of the beast. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Notre Dame, Mom. Try to keep up. I'm just picking on Justin. All right, Nimrod. Anybody know who Nimrod? How many generations was he from Adam?
13.
He was the 13th from Adam. How many letters are in his name?
Six.
There it is again. The 13th generation from Adam is a man named Nimrod, and he's the one that builds Babel. The beginning of his kingdom was Babylon, Genesis 10:10. Now those two numbers are going to be important too, because 10 in Roman numerals is X, and there's 10 horns and 10 toes. We're starting to get ahead of ourselves, but just keep bearing with me. This name in Hebrew looks like this. Nimrod. You ever heard this? Ben Kish. You ever heard that?
Yeah.
It means Nimrod, son of Cush. Now in the Hebrew numerics, his name equals, y'all, we really had to guess, didn't we? Alright, then we come to a man named Esau. Esau is the 13th from Noah. The Bible says about this man that he was red, ruddy. It means he's of the earth. The Bible calls him a profane man. Both of these men are said to be hunters. There's only two men in the Bible who are said to be hunters. Esau and Nimrod. Now, it's going to be important because this rider on the white horse shows up with what in his hand?
A bow.
A bow. Now, the old symbol for bow is this right here. When they used to call for archers in the English military, they hold up two fingers. Scouts on. I've got pictures of German troops marching before the Vatican flag, and they're standing there like this. You see? Doesn't mean peace. But everywhere the Pope goes, he's going like this, ain't he? That's where the middle finger come from, flipping people off. They would catch an English bowman and cut his middle finger off. And every English bowman that hadn't been caught would give the French the middle finger. And it was called giving the bird because of the bird feathers on the arrow. Now, listen. This thing hasn't meant peace for 6,000 years. There was a generation that made it mean peace, and they were called Generation
X.
So every time you see a pope now, he's out there giving the sign of the bowman, you see? And it means death. It means to kill. And that's why I pointed out that these men were hunters, but Esau was the 13th from Ad, or the 13th from Noah. All right? Number 13, Esau. Judas Iscariot. How many letters in his name? You don't? Come on. No.
13.
13 letters. There's 13 letters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Son of perdition. Son of perdition. Of is an article that's not in the Hebrew. Son of perdition. 13 letters. Now, 13, 13, 13. All right, Genesis 13, 13. Go ahead and flip there, please, somebody.
But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly.
First time the word sinner shows up in your Bible is Genesis 13, 13. And it's talking about men of two cities. Sodom and what?
Gomorrah.
Anybody just want to just take a wild guess?
There's 13 letters in it?
13 letters. The difference between me and most people is I believe my God can do this, you see. I believe my God can put together a book.
Amen.
It's amazing. Call upon me and I will answer thee and show thee great mighty things that thou knowest not. You may want to take a gander at Isaiah 13 sometime. You may want to take a gander at 2 Corinthians 11:13. And you may want to read Deuteronomy 13. That one's about the false prophet right there, who shows up later in Revelation chapter 13. Now, we got these numbers. Now let me get going here and I'll be done. I really am about done. Let me explain this horde to you, and then we'll cover the mark, the sign, and the letter X and all this stuff next week. But you see, listen to me, folks, if you get what I'm talking about, when you come across the 13th chapter of any book in that Bible, or a multiple of 13, you're going to start looking very carefully for the Antichrist. I do it. I do it time and time again. I used to read Deuteronomy 13 and read over there where God said, if there come a prophet with signs, and his signs come to pass, and he tells you to go after another god, thou shalt not hearken unto that prophet. For the Lord your God proveth you to see whether you love the Lord with all your heart, you see? You know what that chapter's about? That chapter's about the false prophet. All right, now, that woman that shows up on the back of that beast in Revelation 17, this woman is found throughout the Bible. She's found in Proverbs and all through there. But Christ mentions her specifically in Matthew chapter... Take a guess, somebody. 33. And he said, the kingdom of heaven is likened to a woman which took leaven and hid that leaven in 3 measures of meal. You find her again in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, and her name is Jezebel. Jezebel was a Baalite. She worshipped Baal. Now here's some, we're identifying the whore. She's called the mother of abominations. That means every abominable thing on this earth came from her. And her name is Babylon. But who is she? Well, Baalism worships on Sunday. They celebrate a holiday in which they celebrate the birth of the sun god. It's called winter solstice. I think they call it. I ain't going to put Christ's name in it. Y'all can if you want to. I ain't going to. Xmas is what I call it. There it is again. You say you celebrate Christmas? Yeah, I have Christmas. But I at least meant it's pagan. At least I got the nerve to say it's pagan. Y'all go ahead and keep pretending all you want to. I'm not going to. But I do like what one preacher said. He said, we celebrate Easter and Christmas. He said, why? He said, because all year we're telling the people to get their mind on Jesus Christ, and then when they do it on Christmas, we tell them wrong day. Hey, man, if I can use Christmas to get people into church and tell them about Jesus Christ, I'll do it.
Amen.
They used to bake cakes for a woman, the Baalites did. You can find that over in Jeremiah. They was kneading cakes for the Queen of Heaven. Their priests wore long black robes and were called Father. Is it looking familiar yet?
Yes.
They mutilated themselves during prayer. Mutilation in prayer. Remember them cutting with lances? Having Baal to answer them? Mutilation in prayer. There's another group that does that too. No idea. What about the fact that she's wearing purple and scarlet? Them collars sound familiar?
The red one?
Yes. Where are you at? What about the fact that she's decked out in gold and precious stones and has a golden cup in her hand and she's drunk with the blood? She's drunk with blood. There's only one church in this world. Only one religion in this world that takes a golden cup and professes to be drinking blood.
Yep.
Now let's quit beating around the bush and just jump up to Revelation 17 and 18. Verse 18 again. There it is. 666. Verse 18. The woman which thou sawest is what? That great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth. What city reigned over the kings of the earth when Revelation was written?
Rome.
There's no mistaking who that woman is. She's Rome. And her religion is Catholic. Now take this word right here, and I'm done with this right here, and we'll pick up with the rest of it next time. Because we still got some stuff on this right here. This in Hebrew comes out to 666, Roman. The Roman language, Latin. In Greek is Latinos, comes out to 666. But I'm going to end with this right here. The word Catholic. Now we'll go over some of this stuff more next time. But when you get down and you study the beast in Revelation 13, that beast is likened to a what?
Leper.
A leper. It's a cat. Or a felix in Latin, X. Or a black cat, which is a Styx felix. In America, it's called a lynx. But if it's a half man and a half cat, it's called a sphinx. Down there in Egypt, you see. And if you look at Egypt, if you looked at the pyramids from over top, they would look like this. They look like three X's in a row, and then the sphinx would sit right here, and X marks the spot. Pow. I know the mystery of the pyramids. Don't talk to me about it. Go on and study. We'll have a conversation about it. I told a boy one day at school, I said, "Man, you can't have an intelligent conversation." He said, "Why?" I said, "You don't read. You've been told what to think your whole life by television and everything else, and you don't read, mean you can't talk." And now watch this. The Catholics will tell you that the word Catholic means universal. Chuck, you were raised a Catholic, is that right?
Right.
They say the word Catholic means universal. This part does. An alcoholic is completely given to alcohol.
Right.
You hear me? Mm-hmm. So what is a catholic? We can trace that word all the way back, man. A halo, heil, hell, Heil Hitler, holy, whole. I mean, we have no problem figuring out what the word holic means. But watch this. What are they wholly, completely given over to is the question. She shows up riding on the back of a beast. And could it be possible that she is completely, totally given over to that cat? Revelation 13, the leopard, the beast. Jesus Christ is likened to a lamb without spot. The leopard, what's the defining mark of a leopard? Black what?
Spot.
Black spots, or in Latin, the word for black in Greek is styx, and the word for spot in Latin is pox. Chicken what?
Pox.
All right. What was this? The small what?
Pox.
You know how many times the word spot shows up in Revelation 13 or Deuteronomy or Leviticus chapter 13? You know how many times the word spot shows up in that chapter? Any idea?
13
times. Now, folks, we're going to get to the rest of these. I gave you an introduction tonight. I had to point out that we're dealing with Roman Catholicism because we're going to get into the Latin language. Roman numerals. When you take the Roman numerals, XV, LC, MD, they come out to 666. Every number below 1,000 equals 666. The Pope used to wear a hat, Vicarius Filii. Any idea? Y'all want to just take a stab at what that comes out to in Roman numerics? 666. Now we're going to be dealing with Latin. We had to get the thing out that she's Catholic. That this mystery of iniquity, this great whore. While we are the true bride of Christ, me and you, the whore is the Roman Catholic Church. And we're going to start talking about her Latin and how she's going to bring the Antichrist into this world. Let's pray.
Paul, one more thing. Before we close in prayer, there's one thing that I'd like to mention. Probably you're not aware of it. One thing that will be presented to the Supreme Court to make a decision is, and this goes along with what we've been talking about in Revelation 13, that no man might buy nor sell. One decision the Supreme Court is going to make is whether or not, after you purchase something, if you have the right to resell it. That will be presented before the Supreme Court very soon. It's all, everything is in motion to bring out that mark. No man might buy nor sell. It's things we need to be aware of. All right, Paul, go ahead.
I don't want to lose my spot where I'm at, so don't erase this, please. It didn't break, actually.
I'm sorry?
It didn't break.